Hello and welcome to M Coding. I'm James Murphy. Let's get going talking about descriptors. Contrary to how the name might sound, descriptors are not the mutual enemy of Autobots and Decepticons, nor do they have anything to do with descriptions. Descriptors in Python are somewhat of a feature that's hidden in plain sight. Officially, an object is a descriptor if it has any of these dunder get, set, or delete methods. And their purpose is to allow you to customize what it means to get, set, or delete an attribute. In this case, x is an instance of the descriptor on the left. When you call object.x, this calls the descriptor's get method. When you call object.x equals something, that calls the set method. And when you call del object.x, that calls the delete. Get takes the object and the object type. Importantly, this allows you to do different things based off of whether something was called from an instance or the class itself. If this is your first time hearing about descriptors in Python, you're probably thinking this is one of those very niche features that's advanced use only, and oh, by the way, isn't that the same thing as getAdder, setAdder, and delAdder? Why is there a need for descriptors at all? It is true that without knowing more about the internals of your class, something.x could be calling the getAdder, or it could be calling the get method of a descriptor. Object.x equals something could be calling the setAdder, or it could be calling a set of a descriptor. And del object.x could be calling a del adder or a delete of a descriptor. Without seeing the internals of the class, you just can't tell. But there's a big difference between get adder, set adder, and del adder versus the descriptor versions. Namely, the methods on the right-hand side are defined per class, whereas the ones on the left-hand side are defined per attribute. On the right, it's the class that's determining how to access attributes, whereas on the left, it's the attribute itself that determines how it's accessed. Even still, you may be thinking, descriptors, I'm never going to need that, right? I never define descriptors, I never work with descriptors, I don't need to know. Well, welcome to my list of descriptors hiding in plain sight. You may not have realized it, but you're using them all the time. Hidden descriptor number one, functions. Have you ever noticed the difference that you get when you access a function through an instance versus through the class? Accessing the function f through an instance little a, we get a bound method. But accessing the same f through the class itself gives us a function object. It's the same f in both cases, but I'm getting different results. That's because every function you define with the def keyword is a descriptor that defines a get method. And it uses the descriptor protocol to do something different based off of whether it was called from an instance or the class itself. Functions in Python are written in C, so this isn't exactly what it's doing, but it's something close to this. Every function has a get method. If the object is none, then there's no instance associated to this lookup, meaning it was called from a class object itself. In that case, we just return the function as is. Otherwise, object isn't none, and we're in a case like this, where we're looking up a function on an actual instance variable. And in that case, instead of returning the function itself, we return some kind of bound function that remembers the object. So yeah, if you're using functions, then you're using descriptors. Number two descriptor hidden in plain sight, properties. And yes, this is a different case than just functions. Let me show you why. Let's reach into the class's dictionary and print out what this area thing actually is. I'm accessing it through the dictionary like this in order to avoid invoking the descriptor. We see that area is not actually a function, it's a property object. First, area is defined as a function just like normal. Then you replace area with whatever you get by calling property on it. That's why technically area is a property object, not a function. So this is exactly the same as this. And property is a descriptor, so it controls what it does when you say .area. It just so happens that what it does is call that original area function. Properties like this are never really needed, you could always just call the function directly. But it's a common way to indicate to the programmer that this thing is really cheap to compute. By making area a property, you're basically telling users that area is so cheap to compute that it's basically as free as an attribute access. If for some reason your area function really was expensive, then make it look expensive. Don't hide the fact that it's a function call, just make that explicit. Funnily enough, the main reason that I see people use properties is actually to introduce a feature to Python that was specifically left out of the language. By design in Python, all attributes are public. There's no way to prevent someone from accessing internal implementation details of your classes. And aside from inheriting from a built-in type like tuple, this also makes it impossible to make truly immutable types. But this is a pretty common pattern to prevent people from accidentally mutating your object. Add an underscore to the beginning of your attribute name, then make a property with the same name without the underscore. People can still read the name, no problem. But if they try to write to it, they get an error. But of course, this isn't true immutability. Someone could just reach inside and manually change the underscore variable name. but it's pretty much an unspoken rule in Python that if you have an underscore variable or underscore function, then you're not meant to touch those. So if you do change an underscore variable or call an underscore function, then you should expect everything to break. It's your own fault. Anyway, here's how you might implement property if you were doing it yourself. The built-in property also does set and delete, but you get the idea. As per usual, if you weren't passed an instance, then just return the property itself. Otherwise, call the stored function on the instance that was passed in. Hidden descriptor number 3, class methods and static methods. Both class and static methods allow you to call a function whether you have an instance of the class or the class itself. In both cases, since you might not have an instance to work with, there's no self parameter. And the difference is that a static method has no implied parameters, whereas a class method has an implied class parameter. So in both of these cases, whether you called with the capital animal class or the lowercase animal instance, the class parameter of the create function will be filled in with the animal class. I have a whole video on class methods versus static methods. Check that out if you want to hear more. As far as possible implementations go, they could look something like this. Just like properties, both of these take and remember the function that they're applied to. Static method is much simpler. Whether you were called with an instance or not, just always return the function back. Class method is a bit trickier because we need to supply that class parameter. If we weren't passed the type to use, then we just use the type of the object. Then this is how we bind that object to the class parameter. Remember, functions are descriptors. And the get method returns a bound version of the function where the first argument is bound to the first argument of the get. It's not totally clear if the second argument matters at all, but this works. So as you can see, descriptors are often used to make sort of function object-like things, but that's not all they're useful for. Let's take a look at number 4, slots. This is another one that I have a full video on, but here's the quick rundown. Normally, objects have an instance dictionary. Anytime you store a variable into the object, it really just stores it inside this dictionary. But especially for small objects, dictionaries aren't necessarily the most efficient way to store things. If you define slots equals XYZ, then you're saying the only three attributes that my instances are going to have are X, Y, and Z. You can get, set, and delete X, Y, and Z, no problem. But if you try to get, set, or delete W, then you get an error. Once again, directly reaching inside the class's dictionary, we see that X is a member object. These slots members also define all three of get, set, and delete. And because there's no instance dictionary to manage this, these get, set, and delete have to reach into the underlying C structure of the objects and manually modify them. Again, see my video on slots if you'd like to hear more. And speaking of instance dictionaries, do you know what else are descriptors? Instance dictionaries. The dunder dict attribute of any class that has instance dictionaries isn't a dictionary. It's an attribute object, which is a descriptor with all three of get, set, and delete. And notice this weird idiom that I had to do in order to see this attribute object. I had to reach into the dictionary of the class and then read the dictionary. If you print out just the dict, it looks like a dictionary. But if you look at the type, you see that it's actually a mapping proxy object. This happens because remember, dict is a descriptor. So accessing e.dunderdict invokes the descriptor. And what the descriptor does is return this proxy object instead of the actual attribute. So that's why we had to do this double dunderdict thing. Moving on, how about a real-world library use case of descriptors? Look no further than one of the most popular Python packages of all time, SQLAlchemy. SQLAlchemy lets you communicate with databases through Python in a Pythonic way. Here I define a user account table with two fields, ID and name. When I define the class, I say that ID is a column that takes integers and name is a column that takes strings. When I operate on an actual instance of the class, I'm working not with column objects, but with actual ints and strings. Getting different behavior on a class versus an instance? You guessed it, they're descriptors. Number 7, another common use for descriptors is field validation. For example, I want to say here, this item has a price that's greater than 0. Whenever I set a price, I want to make sure that it's positive. And if not, I want an error. This functionality is accomplished in the set method. Before setting the attribute, check if it's bigger than 0, otherwise throw a value error. Then proceed with setting the attribute. This is an interesting use case for Python's dunder set name. This function is called at class construction time, and its purpose is to let each object know what its name is. After the class body runs, this greater than object will be told that its name is price by having the set name called, with the owner being the item class and the name being price. In this case, I'll prepend an underscore to the name and then use that as the sort of private location where I'm storing the actual data. So the descriptor is stored at .price, but the value that's underlying the price, the actual price, gets stored at dot underscore price. Knowing the name that we're assigned to is a good way to avoid conflicts if you have multiple of these descriptors in the same class. So if I also had a quantity field, then there wouldn't be any fight over where to store each of them. They each have their own private location. And the final descriptor on my list is super lookups. Suppose I have a package class that can ship to some address, and an express package that ships faster. I don't really recommend doing this, but you can set a base view onto your class. Create a super object and stick it on there. If you ship an express package, it's on the way right away. But if you call ship on the base view, then you'll get the parent's behavior. I'm not going to go into why this works here. I have a whole video on super if you want to see the gory details. This next portion is slightly more advanced and deals with some tricky issues you might run into. So if a descriptor's get method and a class's get adder method can both define what it means to say object.something, then what happens if you have a class that has both? I encourage you to take this example and try commenting and uncommenting things to see how things actually work. The first trip up is that there's not just one getAdder, there's getAdder and getAttribute. And getAttribute is actually the one that's more similar to setAdder and delAdder. GetAttribute, setAdder, and delAdder are all always called. When you say object.something, getAttribute is always called. When you say object.something equals, setAdder is always called. When you say delObject.something, delAdder is always called. And for these three functions, it's actually the base object class whose versions of those functions actually implement the descriptor logic. So if you're defining getAttribute, setAdder, or delAdder, then you should call the base object's version of that function inside your implementation if you want it to work with descriptors. If you don't call the base object's version, you'll find that your descriptor methods get, set, delete are not called, unless, of course, you manually call them in your version of the function. That's to say, you can sort of override the descriptor protocol if you so choose. And then there's getAdder, which is actually only called if getAttribute raises an attribute error. So how does getAttribute decide what order to do things in? The object version of getAttribute has a series of fallbacks that it tries to figure out which one is the best one to call. If it finds a descriptor that has a get and a set or delete, then that's called a data descriptor and it has the highest priority. Next, it checks inside the instance dictionary. Then it checks for descriptors that just have a get. These are called non-data descriptors. Then it checks for variables found at the class level. Then it'll raise an attribute error, which triggers the getAdder if it exists. These defaults are definitely not obvious, although they are generally good for most use cases. It may feel especially weird that instance variables are split between these data versus non-data descriptors. The reason that non-data descriptors get lower priority than instance variables is because the most common use case for these is caching. The descriptor computes some expensive variable and then saves it in the instance dictionary. The next time it gets looked up, it's found in the instance dictionary and isn't recomputed. This was chosen because of how common caching is, but if you want your descriptor to always be preferred, then you can just define a set or delete that just does the default thing. Here's a case where you can see that priority difference play out. For X, I have a data descriptor. It defines both a get and a set, whereas Y just has a get. Both of our gets return none, so when we print X and Y, we get none, none. Then for both X and Y, we store 42 in the instance dictionary. Print them out again, and for X, we get none, but for Y, we get 42. This is because the data descriptor's get, which returns none, has a higher priority than the dict, whereas the non-data descriptor's get is not called because the dictionary has higher priority in that case. Obviously, the rules are complex, non-intuitive, and I don't expect you to get them in one go. I just hope this helps you remember that there is some subtlety there, and you might want to look into it if you're ever defining a descriptor like this. Anyway, thanks for making it to the end. I hope you enjoyed it. As always, thank you to my patrons and donors for supporting me. If you enjoy my content, please consider subscribing, and if you especially enjoy, please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. Don't forget to slap that like button an odd number of times. See you next time!